All right, my name is Microphone Bill. I'm here with one of the great players of music, Mr. Junior Marvin.
One love.
Yes, sir.
For everyone.
Before we go into Junior Marvin's story, I just got to ask one question. If you got a chance to play between Bob Marley and Stevie Wonder, who do you choose?
Very good question. I would say it's an almost impossible answer because they're both great, both legends. And I don't know. Tell them the rest of the story.
But this guy had the opportunity. I mean, this guy was sought after by Stevie Wonder. And while he was being sought after by Stevie Wonder, he was being summoned by Bob Marley. I mean, what is that about?
That was like, what they say, cloud nine, when you're on cloud nine, you know. I was in London at the time, and I got a phone call from New York, and it was Stevie Wonder. And on the same day, I had an appointment with Bob Marley, not knowing that I would get the same question from both of them. And eventually, not being able to make the decision myself, I called all my school friends and my parents, my mother, father, sister, everybody. Say, what do you think I should do? And they said, well, just because Bob is born in Jamaica and you were born in Jamaica, give Bob the edge.
Stevie
actually was a very good friend of Bob, so he said, listen, you know, if it doesn't work out, give me a call.
What instrument do you play? I mean, like, just tell the people.
I'm basically known for my lead guitar playing. I play rhythm guitar, you know, acoustic guitar, electric guitar, a little bit of bass guitar, a little bit of piano, percussion, and as much vocal as I can muster.
So what were you doing at the time that made you such a sought-after, you know, player?
I don't know. I think at the time I was growing up in the UK, and I was, you know, very connected to all the music, like the Beatles music, American R&B music, Aretha Franklin, King Curtis, Otis Redding, you know. Talk about Jimi Hendrix, talk about the Beatles, talk about Stevie Wonder, talk about Aretha Franklin, you know, and the list went on and on and on. And coming up in the musical family, I was very fortunate to have good tutoring from my father and my aunt, who was like a professor in music and a teacher in Jamaica. And so everyone in the family, whether we liked it or not, we had to play before we could even walk. And talk properly. Plonk you on the piano, get on the piano. But it was great. And I evolved to coming to the United States and meeting up with T-Bone Walker and playing with him and playing with Ike and Tina Turner and playing with Billy Preston and groups from England like Traffic and from Jamaica, Toots and the Maytals.
Wow.
So at that time, I was doing a lot of work.
You're busy.
Yeah, I was pretty busy for my age and everything. But I used to practice like 8 hours a day, you know, so it wasn't just an easy thing. I had to really work very hard. Every single day, practice, practice, practice. So a lot of young people coming up, whether you're playing basketball or music or want to be a lawyer or whatever, you just got to work really hard at it every day, you know.
Well, playing with Bob Marley, what is something that you learned from playing with an artist like Bob Marley?
Well, one, he was a workaholic, you know, I think similar to Stevie Wonder and Sly and the Family Stone and Prince and Lenny Kravitz, people like that. They're all kind of like workaholics. You know, Michael Jackson, you know, this music 24/7.
And
they love it so much, they just can't stop doing it. And they develop this talent, you know. So, Bob,
you as well, though, have been doing music for many years since then. And
Bob was a workaholic. Whatever he did, whether it was playing soccer or music or ladies, he had to be a workaholic, you know. But he was a great guy and very disciplined and great leader for the band.
I was reading your last CD cover, and I was just noticing, like, the different array of artists that you're working with nowadays. I mean, like, what does that feel like to have the respect of so many different, you know, genres of artists, you know?
I think once you love music, you know, you just love something that's really a blessing, you know, and people who love music love people, love you know, love to be of service.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's part of that gift, you know. What's like when you play great basketball, you're sharing your gift, your talent, and people are like in awe. Man, can I touch him? You know, he's great. And they want to be just like you. They don't really want to be put up on a pedestal. And they want to be like everybody else, but at the same time, contribute something to everyone, you know, like one love, Bob Marley. Hey, it's a great contribution, you know.
Other than Bob Marley, who has made an impression on you as an artist? You know, someone like maybe from another genre of music, you know, someone that you like built some kind of connection to?
Muhammad Ali. I mean, like, he was very poetic,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, very musical in the way that he did his sport. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, he danced when he boxed. It was a dance, you know. The shuffle was a dance. And like, it made a poetic thing out of it, made an artistic thing out of it. And it was very entertaining, and he made you feel proud of yourself, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you're growing up, you look at Muhammad Ali, he's good looking, he's a boxer, he's telling everyone to enjoy life, you know. And, you know, to be proud of yourself, and everyone, respect everyone. So that was a great inspiration for me.
All right, well, one last question I have to ask you. Like, I've seen on your album cover that you worked with like artists like Lenny Kravitz and stuff like that. Like, what is that kind of like? I mean, you like, you know.
Well, I grew up in England, so a lot of people think that I'm really British, you know, although I'm born in Jamaica, and I love the American vibe too, you know, but I don't know. I think it's cool, you know.
Yeah, yeah. That concert, which is, you know, like in a historical event, basically in time, especially for, you know, Jamaican people, you know, Rasta people and all that. Can you, as an individual who are on stage, who witnessed this event, could you just give us, you know, what your, you know, perception of what happened that day?
Well, One Love Peace Concert in Jamaica was my first concert in my own country,
okay,
with Bob Marley. It's like, you know, playing in England with the Rolling Stones,
right,
or playing in America with one of the top artists like Stevie Wonder, you know. Mm. So being in Jamaica with Bob, and the whole country was supporting peace and peace between political parties. So the music was very intense, and the cause was very like, you know, very much a one love and like a message to the whole world. So to play in something like that with like 80,000 people, you know, it was really awesome.
Yeah. Makes you like a soldier of war.
Well, not really of war, a soldier of love.
A soldier of love, yes, indeed, yes. You got two new CDs that I've seen, and you know, they got a very eclectic style of music on them. Give us a little, you know, annotation about, you know, what you did with these two different CDs that you have.
Well, the first CD, which is a compilation, title Smoking to the Big End Music. It's a little compilation of songs that I've recorded and released over the years from late 70s right up until now. And it's like maybe 7 different albums with 2 songs from each album.
Okay.
And then the dub album, you know, a lot of people have been learning about dub music from Jamaica over the last 5 years, although it's been around for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I've always loved it, and this was my first contribution to that style of music from Jamaica, which is dub, you know, dub-wise. So that's titled Lion to Zion, dub-wise. And you have tracks like Preacher Man,
mm-hmm.
You have tracks like Soup Dub, Love, Love, Love Dub.
Okay.
And then on Smoking to the Big M, you have tracks like Life Without You, which is about Bob Marley's passing. Mm-hmm. You know, you have
All Day.
All Day. And then you have
A Mystic Vibes favorite.
All right. You know, and there's quite a few different, you know, selections there.
2013, we have like a legend. I mean, you are actually like, you know, somebody who has been in the music business for many years, and we got to give love for an individual like that. Chicago, when is the last time before today that you've been here?
Well, I played here for the final show of the Wild here.
Okay.
And I was a little bit sad about that because it's such a nice venue with a lot of music passing through there. The Wailers Band, original Wailers, everyone's, you know, all the Marley kids different, you know, everyone's performed or passed through the wild hair, you know.
And so now we got 2013, we're out here in the park.
Well, that's great, yeah. Great to be back here doing this festival. I've heard about it before. I heard it's something that happens every year, and it's growing every year. It's got a new venue, which is here, Union Park. And my performance was like right before the sunset, and I felt good.
People were moving.
Everybody was dancing, and now they're getting ready for Inner Circle.
Yes, yes, yes.
And got tomorrow as well, so it's been great, you know,
right,
with Third
right.
World and people like that playing.
Yeah. It's been a pleasure to have you touch ground here in the Chi-Town area, for real.
My pleasure. One love.
For real. Mystic Vibes, Julian Marvin.
Mystic Vibes. Greetings, one love. This is Junior Marvin right here in Chi-Town with Giselle McKenzie. Mystic Vibes, loving it every time. Stay with Giselle, you're gonna love it more. Junior Marvin, Bob Marley and the Wailers, one love.
Say no!